Hi, and welcome back to Channel One. This is the Digital Nations channel, and we are continuing our amazing conversations with members of the Digital Nations about case studies and what it's like to be in the Digital Nations. Now we're going to turn our attention to something very important. This is a topic that's near and dear to the hearts of all nation members, but also very precious to Minister Murray, Canada's Minister of Digital Government, who has a storied background in environmental legislation and being progressive about environmental issues, both in British Columbia, where she's from, and at the federal level. So digital government and digital technology in general has an ambivalent relationship with the environment. We love to think of digital as clean, and certainly this year, the reduction in carbon emissions just from not getting on planes and traveling around the world has been remarkable. So we've proven that digital can help us. But what's often not seen is just how much the carbon footprint of digital can consume resources and pollute the air. Everything from Bitcoin mining, which uses computation of hard problems as a proof of work, to video conferencing, to broadband, all of these things consume a tremendous amount of information. And so we are stuck on this sort of horns of dilemma, where on the one hand, we want to reduce greenhouse gases. On the other hand, we have a voracious appetite for digital technology. So this is such a big issue for Canada and for the world in general that we thought we'd invite some folks from the Digital Nations to have a conversation about reconciling digital demand with environmental sustainability. And to host this panel, I'm going to welcome Denis Skinner. Denis, how are you doing today?
I'm pretty good. How about you?
I'm doing okay, all things considered. I got a lot of coffee in me right now, I can't lie. But it's going well, and I'm thrilled to see people are interacting, you know, with the Digital Nations and then on the rest of the platform too. I'm going to leave you here with the rest of your panelists, Karen, and you guys can get started right away. But have fun, and I'll be back in about 40 minutes to wrap things up with you.
Great, thanks a bunch. Okay, well, welcome to this session on digital transformation and environmental governance. My name is Denis Skinner, and I'm your host for today's session. I'm the Executive Director of Digital Change in the Office of a Chief Information Officer. I'm also one of Canada's leads to the Digital Nations. Now, throughout this pandemic, we've seen how digital tech innovations are exponentially accelerating government's ability to deliver services to citizens. We've seen what's possible when we have the right priorities, and now it's time to focus on the impact that technology has on the environment. Moving into the second phase of the pandemic, we've committed to green recovery. As you've heard today, Canada's leading Digital Nations thematic working group on greening IT to ensure the environmental sustainability is a cornerstone of our digital recovery efforts. So Canada's also launching its own updated greening governance strategy to reduce the environmental impact on our operations. In addition, technology holds tremendous opportunity to support environmental monitoring, protection, enforcement, all driven, for example, by advances in AI. To expand on these ideas, I'd like to welcome our two distinguished speakers for today, Dr. Karen Baker and Mr. David Jensen. So we'll start by opening remarks, and then we'll go into the discussion with some good questions. And I really hope that you're both, Dr. Karen and David, really bold in these discussions, really push our thinking how Digital Nations can build a greener future for us. So Karen, I'll pass the floor to you to start the conversation.
Great, thanks, Denis. Thanks for the warm welcome. Looking forward to the discussion. Can you see my screen? I know there were some tech issues just before we launched the session. Not sure? Well, I'll begin, but I'll add a little extra detail to my comments just in case people are not seeing the slides. So to begin, I'm going to paint a big picture, and then David Jensen, who's doing extremely important work at UNEP, will follow with some specific remarks relevant to digital government. But let me paint a larger picture for you, and that picture has to do with the rise of digital earth technologies. During the past two decades, an enormous revolution has taken place, and this has enabled us to wire up the world. Instrumentation advances, satellites, drones, sensors, robots, much of which are now interconnected through Internet of Things, environmental sensor networks, ICT systems, with an added layer of intelligence, machine learning, such as computer vision or digital bioacoustics and ecoacoustics. And I've put a link in here to an academic reading that may be of interest in case people want to follow up on a meta review we did of this rapidly expanding field a couple of years ago. Now, this field is very diverse. It covers everything from computational sustainability to ecological informatics. And what it is doing is enabling a transformation in environmental governance. The first radical transformation, which you've probably heard about, is an exponential increase in our ability to effectively monitor the environment. Here's just one example of smart oceans systems, instrumentation of the ocean through subsurface, seafloor, floating devices, drones, remote sensing. I mean, we're wiring up the oceans at an unprecedented rate, and this is occurring across terrestrial and marine ecosystems around the world. The second set of advances is in conservation. I'll just give you one example of thousands. This is an underwater autonomous vehicle. It's programmed to patrol the Great Barrier Reef. It uses computer vision to identify a specific invasive species, crown of thorns starfish, and it kills those starfish by lethal injection with over 97% success rate. So the notion of automating invasive species eradication is now a reality in some parts of the globe. A third prong of the digital earth innovation agenda is hazard prevention. Here's just one example. River track, this is live in Scotland. Rivers that are likely to flood are fitted with sensors installed on a structure just above the normal high watermark. And this is really direct to user focus. So residents are alerted in real time about rising waters and floods. And of course, you've probably heard of the ways in which satellite data, remote sensing, LIDAR, and other technologies are being used to enhance firefighting abilities, another important set of advances in hazard mitigation. Fourth set of advances that you might be less aware of has to do with the intersection of citizen science and artificial intelligence. There's been an enormous set of advances around the machine learning applications that take large amounts of data, photos, often provided by citizen scientists, in order to enhance conservation goals. Here's one of the pioneers in this agenda, Dr. Tanya Berger-Wolf. Her original app that used methods similar to fingerprint readers for zebras has now been generalized and scaled up to Wildbook, which her team calls Facebook for World Wildlife, and it's being used for hundreds of species around the world, enabling much more efficient identification and censuses, complete censuses of the world's wildlife, with important implications for conservation. The final set of advances is to do with immersive technologies, augmented reality, virtual and mixed reality. Here's just one example. This is Jeremy Bailenson's lab at Stanford. This is the ocean acidification experience. Here you see some senators participating. This is now one of the world's largest ongoing VR experiments. And Bailenson's research shows that participating in VR experiences of environmental degradation enhances environmentally friendly behaviors on the part of users very significant way, much more than watching 2D videos or reading text online. So there's a lot of potential for using immersive technologies to stimulate environmentally positive behaviors. Now, I've gathered a database of over 4,000 such applications, and so time does not permit me to share all of them with you. Suffice to say, they're exciting, they're diverse, and there are lots of potential innovative applications that government will have to get its head around in the next few years. I'll briefly mention four. The first, mobile conservation. We're now evolving the first set of truly mobile marine protected areas globally. These protected areas are computationally intensive. They rely on a combination of sensors and satellite data and oceanographic and climatological modeling. They follow the fish, they follow the turtles. So for example, this is currently used off the coast of Australia for endangered bluefin tuna. And with the current renegotiation of the Convention on the Law of the Sea and the Convention on Biological Diversity, there's hope that mobile marine protected areas might become the norm in open oceans governance. We certainly have the scientific basis to make that happen. Another cool set of innovations about enforcement and third-party monitoring. You may have heard of MethaneSat. It's the private satellite launched by Environmental Defense Fund in Harvard with some ex-NASA engineers operating in target mode. That satellite is really focusing on reducing specifically fugitive methane emissions from the oil and gas value chain with a goal of really accelerating our ability to reach climate change targets, particularly in the absence of government action. Third set of innovations, AI-driven algorithms that dramatically enhance conservation efforts. This will soon be coming to parks in Canada, probably. This is Fei Fang, a machine learning and computer scientist at Carnegie Mellon. Her algorithm, the Protection Assistant for Wildlife Security, is now being rolled out to more than 800 protected areas in more than 60 countries. And it blends machine learning and game theory to predict poaching hotspots, with test pilots in Uganda, Cambodia, Indonesia, showing a high degree of success of increasing detection of poachers and also snare and trap removal. Finally, one of my personal favorites, climate change responsive and adaptive wetland management. Since 2015 in California's Central Valley, the Nature Conservancy has been collaborating with Cornell University to create pop-up wetlands. So this uses a combination of sensor and satellite data with citizen science observations through the Cornell eBird citizen science app. The result is that there's a high degree of specificity about when and where migratory birds are likely to land. When they land, the lack of wetlands due to California's drought and industrial agriculture is a big concern. And so farmers are paid through a reverse auction system to flood their fields and provide temporary habitat for birds, which has had a very successful impact not only on the numbers of birds, but also species diversity of both shorebirds and other avians. I'm very excited to talk more about the upside of these technologies, but there are lots of downsides. I'll just sketch them out here and hope that we can dive in the discussion. The data challenges are significant, particularly redundancy, security, and quality control if we're going to use these for automated decision-making systems. The regulatory and legal challenges are very significant given challenges like algorithmic bias, the need to have robust traceability, the very complicated ethical implications of relying on citizens to produce data, and of course, indigenous data sovereignty, which is, I think, top of mind for the digital environmental agenda internationally, but certainly should be in Canada. And finally, significant potential environmental impacts. All of these devices, the instrumentation has the potential to generate an enormous amount of e-waste. It does require significant amounts of energy, and we need a lot of innovation on this front to make sure that we're not littering the environment with discarded sensors as we try to save endangered species. So I'll throw those challenges out to the audience and now move on to David. And David is doing some very important work at UNEP regarding the data challenges and global frameworks for governance of environmental data. So over to you, David.
Great. Thank you very much, Karen. Just nod your head if you can hear me. Thanks very much. That was a fantastic introduction to this particular space. And I'm going to drill down a little bit more into harnessing digital transformation to really amplify and accelerate environmental sustainability. And I'm also going to provide kind of that big picture overview, which we can then drill down on. So I think everybody in the audience is very aware that there are these two core megatrends sweeping the planet right now. On the one hand, we have a whole series of compounding environmental crises, the climate crises, the nature crises, the pollution crises. And on the other hand, we have digital transformation. And that is fundamentally transforming our economy, our social relationships, our institutions, and even our very humanity. And the challenge really is how to bring these two together. So as you just mentioned, there's an incredible convergence of digital technologies ongoing right now. And I won't list all of them. You mentioned many of them. But the real important thing to understand is this is creating now this superabundance of environmental data and analytics. And the question now is basically, how do we begin to harness this to drive forward digital sustainability? Now, the thing about the superabundance is really there's this unprecedented flow of data, and it is now basically at a speed that's never before been seen at a scale. Most of the data is anchored spatially. There's multiple sources in terms of public sector, private sector, and the scope of what we can measure is also huge. So this unprecedented flow of data and analytics on the environment. And this is giving us the potential finally for real-time feedback, for transparency, and for dealing with environmental complexity. So this is huge. And you know, these data and analytics really hold more potential than ever before to start shaping human behavior and planetary conditions, as well as underpin digital environmental sustainability. And we're really standing at this pivotal moment in human history in terms of how we harness this potential. And there are three key challenges we have to address as we take forward. And you mentioned some of these, Karen. first and foremost, although we have access to this incredible supply of data, it's very fragmented and it's of a variable quality. So we need to sort out the fragmentation issues and the quality issues. A lot of the infrastructure needed to actually process the data is in private sector hands and controlled by the private sector. And you know, this is not necessarily a bad thing, provided there are governance frameworks for that. And the third challenge is really, there is this fundamental need for public private collaboration to transform the data into insights and action. So we have to fundamentally address those key challenges. And one of the things we're proposing at the UN Environment Program is to begin to build, together with public and private sector, a concept called the digital ecosystem for the planet. And this is basically simply organizing into an ecosystem the data, the required processing infrastructure, the analytics and insights, and the applications within a general framework and within a set of governance rules and standards. So the digital ecosystem for the planet is what we're advocating. And the digital ecosystem itself must begin to deliver digital public goods in the form of actionable, real-time, and predictive insights that can really advance the sustainable development goals and drive collective action on climate, nature, and pollution targets. So it really has to be anchored in the SDGs and in our global environmental goals. This is going to require unprecedented collaboration between public and private sectors and civil society. And as I mentioned, we're going to have to start with building an inclusive governance framework. And Karen, you pointed to many of these issues already, but we need to define what are essential digital public goods. We have to agree on essential principles and safeguards, transparency. We have to deal with data licensing, semantics and taxonomy, interoperability standards, quality control, and very importantly, the business models that underpin this and establishing a marketplace for environmental analytics. So a lot of issues that we have to sort out in the governance framework. But what we want to do is take that digital ecosystem and then plug it into the core pillars of the economy. Something that might look like this, you know, take the analytics and push it across all these core pillars of the economy. And begin to really hardwire environmental analytics and various sustainability norms into digital value chains. So that's the key part of this proposal, is really hardwiring it and pushing it into the actual algorithms and the code of the digital economy. Now, to accelerate the application of environmental data analytics norms in digital technologies, we feel there are five core missions that public and private sector have to unite to achieve. So the first mission is really focusing on this regulatory pillar. We fundamentally have to be able to measure progress, environmental progress, against our global and national goals in a transparent and rapid way. So we need to collaborate in terms of measurement of environmental progress towards national targets and global targets. In terms of the investment pillar, providing environmental data and analytics to help reveal risks and opportunities for investment capital. So a series of analytics on environment, on climate risk, and opportunities that can really inform and shape markets. The third is looking at the producer side of the chain, and that's basically enabling environmental performance of value chains to be measured and disclosed. We should know the environmental performance of all the products and services on the market in a very clear and transparent way. The fourth is looking at platforms and algorithms, making sure that sustainable consumption norms and goals and targets are coded into content, into algorithms, into filters of all of the digital platforms out there. And finally, focusing on consumers, helping consumers get access to information and incentives that really help them adopt sustainable behaviors, lifestyles, and livelihoods. And the digital ecosystem would really help enable all five of those missions to be achieved. Wrapping up, I want to say this. The digital transformation that we have to undertake has to be harnessed to solve our planetary problems and achieve the SDGs in the next 10 years. Every report basically gives us the 10-year window, and it fundamentally must catalyze exponential change and fundamentally alter the incentive structures of the economy. And here's a graph just showing current CO2 emissions with business as usual. And fundamentally, we need to be using digital technologies to achieve exponential change in bringing these curves down. So meaningful and intelligent public-private partnerships are the key to realizing this vision. And this is what we at the UN Environment Program are very keen to help catalyze. My final slide, in terms of building this digital ecosystem for the planet, the first step is really to co-design an environmental data governance framework, as I mentioned. In 2021, we'd like to kickstart this process. We'd like to convene stakeholders from around the world to begin looking at some of these key issues. And we are looking at six questions. I'm sure more questions will be posed, but these are the six ones that we have in mind right now. First, is environmental data different from other kinds of public data? And if so, what's different about it? And what are the governance structures that need to deal with its differentiation? Who should own environmental data? And how can it be an essential set and managed as a digital public good? What are the core and distinct principles that should govern environmental data? What are the safeguards needed for a public-private collaboration? What business models can be used to finance digital public goods? And as Karen mentioned, how do we begin to mitigate some of the environmental impacts of digital technologies in terms of energy, e-waste, and materials? So that's my overall pitch presentation, core asks, and we would absolutely love to collaborate with all the colleagues who are on this call in terms of co-designing this data governance framework. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you so much, Karen and David, for your opening remarks. So we have remote collection of data and robots executing orders. It's clear that technology is rapidly evolving, a super abundance of data due to the convergence of technologies. Now, with digital government creates an opportunity and also responsibility to transform the public sector's stewardship of both of the environmental data. Can we further explore the challenges and the role of government in that stewardship of data? David, do you want to go first, or Karen?
David.
Yeah, sure. Thanks very much. I mean, one of the key things that governments can do, and this is already being done right now, is just making sure that the government data is open and adopting open data standards, and making sure that anything that the government funds in the UN or the international space comes with the requirement to publish that data in an open source manner. So I think that's really fundamental. And to begin to embrace this idea of digital public goods and licensing not just data, but the entire infrastructure or the entire value chain of data, the algorithms, the software, et cetera, licensing all of that as digital public goods. And adopting policies, again, wherever Canada funds a UN agency, for example, there should be a requirement that any data that is generated in that context becomes a digital public good. So that's certainly one big step forward that they can take.
Can I offer a comment on that, David? I agree in principle, but here's a caveat. In much of the research and governance debates on this, we tend to assume data is owned by no one, environmental data. So unlike human data, where we have a very lively debate on privacy, there is no such analog in the environmental world. I think in the future that will come to be seen to be a mistake, in part because of indigenous data sovereignty. And I think UNDRIP and in particular Canada's commitment to reconciliation means we have to consider this very seriously. There may be some cases when environmental data is owned by indigenous communities and should not be public. Further, I think that there are real risks to releasing this data. So scientists, for example, are very well aware that releasing data about fish location in the absence of very stringent enforcement standards on the open ocean could accelerate precision fishing, accelerating fishing down the food chain and the extirpation of local fish species. So we have to handle this data very sensitively in the absence of effective enforcement and in a broader ethical frame where we simply can't assume that data is there to be taken. There is a kind of an echo here of colonialism or eco-colonialism. You know, we came for the trees, we came for the minerals, now we're coming for the data. And I think that is a really, really important conversation that needs to be held. Especially in countries that are now signatories to UNDRIP.
I couldn't agree more. And that's exactly why we want to have this global conversation exactly on that. You know, how do we put the right safeguards in place when that data is released? What are the core principles that need to inform a governance framework? So I couldn't agree more. There are opportunities and there are risks, very serious risks that need to be taken into account. So clearly, you know, my statement does have certain caveats. There needs to be, you know, a risk assessment when you're looking at a particular data set on the potential consequences, and there needs to be consideration of what those might be. I do think we get into an interesting situation, though, when we start getting into global monitoring, for example, Earth observation, and we begin to pull global data out of satellite data sets. It's a very interesting question there in terms of how do we govern that, especially when it's not being, you know, it's being collected remotely, and it's not being collected, through any, you know, ground measurements. I think that opens up a really, really challenging governance question, and I think that's one of the things we have to talk about in this conversation.
So we have the digital nation, so 10 leaders in digital government, and we're highly interested in making advances in this space. So as a collaboration of 10 countries, what do you recommend should be our first step? What should we look at first? What are the barriers that we could do as a collective to really move this forward?
I think there's a top-down and a bottom-up approach. I think David's approach is very, very important. That is, continue to advance international dialogue and collaboration around an architecture for global environmental data governance. I would call that a kind of top-down approach. And we must be equally mindful that most of the innovations are not happening within government at the moment. They're happening in the private sector, and they're happening across the natural and, to some extent, social sciences. So moving ahead to pilot test some of those innovative applications for immediate conservation goals in order to provide a kind of ground truthed feedback to government is really, really important. For example, I mentioned that I think PAWS, the machine learning game theoretic approach to predicting and preventing poaching, which is now being applied in 800 parks around the world, we need to be learning from those examples as they're being rolled out and applied. We cannot wait for a global environmental data governance framework because innovation is proceeding apace. So on that note, I think an intermediary step for national governments is to think about overhauling environmental assessment and environmental legislation. Our environmental assessment frameworks, for example, don't necessarily take into account the new scientific discoveries with respect to digital noise and the impacts of noise on a broad range of species. So overhauling our environmental assessment frameworks to account for the new science. And then here's the next step. Environmental assessment in the past, because it was done manually, very expensive and time consuming, was sort of a one and done affair. That is, we would do the environmental assessment and then it would be over. There is no technical reason now why we cannot have continuous environmental assessment. And that's aligned with a new political development around something called evolving or continuing consent. That is, consent for projects in the case of indigenous communities need not be given once. It can be given subject to meeting certain environmental standards or thresholds, and consent could be temporarily suspended or revoked should resource extractive projects, for example, fall below certain standards. So these badges of evolving consent, which are very much aligned with UNDRIP and free, prior, and informed consent, are now technically enabled by these computationally intensive approaches. So this actually allows us to advance at a national level and experiment with some of these digital technologies to reach national goals we have already defined as the global conversation goes on. And I think using these digital technologies to advance FIPIC and UNDRIP terrestrially and mobile marine protected areas, particularly off Canada's west coast, to protect the southern resident orcas are urgently needed. We should start on that today.
Key tenet of a digital government is, let's not plan for 10 years, let's start acting now and iterate and learn with a continuous feedback loop. So I do like that a lot, and there's a lot of potential with our procurement practices. When there are grants, we can insert some data collection and consent clauses in there. And that's something that is within our control. David, what do you think on that?
Well, let me just add that I think when we do come up with this data governance framework, that clearly needs to be an agile framework. As you say, the speed of technology goes far beyond the speed of governance. So whatever we come up with as a framework has to be adaptive, has to be light, and it has to be fit for the digital age. And so, you know, we've been thinking, you know, to start with a very basic set of principles and safeguards and seeing if we can get agreement across all of the actors in the digital value chain, from governments all the way to civil society and major companies. So I think that's certainly a starting point. One of the investments that I really like is the idea of a digital product passport, really making sure that any product or service in the market has a digital information about its provenance, about its supply chain, and about its environment and carbon performance. And I'd love to see collaboration across the digital nations exactly on that, so we can have a global standard for digital passports and for measuring the environment and climate performance across the supply chain of a product. That's certainly where I'd start.
Are there interoperability challenges? You mentioned that in one of your slides. From a standards perspective, data standards, international data standards, and we may have data, but we just can't talk to each other because we don't have the same formats. Is something there to be explored further?
There is, very briefly. On the scientific side, there's a lot of work being done with integrated data repositories like Data One or NEON in the US, because even scientific disciplines do not yet have metadata standards and interoperability in the way they collect and store data, much less between scientists and, let's say, the private sector. Huge problem. So where to begin? David, any thoughts?
Well, let me just add that, as you say, it's a big problem. If you look at the world of environmental data platforms, there's probably a new platform that gets stood up every week or two. There's hundreds of platforms out there now that are generating either data or analytics about some particular natural resource or environmental issue, and those platforms are rarely interoperable. And in many ways, they're not built to be interoperable. So I think we have to reimagine how we start designing these platforms and design for interoperability right from the get-go. And again, that's why these governance principles are so important. One of the things I hope we can get to is an international framework where for any platform out there that has environmental data or analytics, there is some kind of seal of approval or certification that they are complying with these international standards or this international governance framework. That's the biggest problem I see right now, is it's really hard to understand the methods, the quality on these platforms, and there's very little transparency in terms of their methodology. So that's, for me, that's a key priority and one of the key rationales for talking about data governance. Yeah.
To bring it back to Canada, and I know we have only 2 minutes left, I'd just like to offer, end on a hopeful note. Canada has an innovation and skills plan. We imagine a digital transformation of our economy. We also have huge commitments to the environment and to a just climate transition. This is where those two goals intersect. It's also enormously inspiring to young people. I can't tell you the number of undergraduates and graduate students who are so inspired at the confluence of digital tech and social good and environmental good. This would revolutionize the ability of the federal government to attract talent in the digital realm if people really saw that the Canadian government was leading on this agenda. So I want to plant the seed of how exciting this would be for you to jump in.
And not only that, but once the Canadian government leads on this agenda domestically, there's a lot of space to lead internationally as well.
It sounds great. Well, you have the interest of the digital nations, and today you had an international audience to hear your insights. So thank you so much for the time today. It was very brief. We got a lot in this short time, and I'm sure you'll have folks that wanted to follow up with you. So thank you so much.
It was a great pleasure.
Merci, Denis.
I didn't know there were killer drones circling the oceans, taking out invasive species. So as Tim said this morning, the future is definitely here, but not distributed evenly. Thank you all very much.